Ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, men and women, nonconformers and non-believers, gender X and gender equals, welcome to Eat the Storms. I am Damien B. Donnelly, this is episode 6, and thank you very much for joining me today. On today's show, I'm going to be joined by 4 very special guests, 3 of which have collections recently launched or about to come out just in time for that early Christmas shopping list. For details about all today's artists and where to find them, just look to the website www.eatthestorms.com, and in the podcast episode listing you can find all the links, or follow us on Instagram at eatthestorms. Today's poems deal with dualities, strengths, dreams taking flight and others coming home. So let's get right on in there. I'm going to start us off today by reading a poem of mine which was published just last week in issue 7 of Inspired magazine. I wrote this poem here in Ireland during lockdown while watching baby birds take their first flights from their nests, and I wondered what happened to those nests I first made when I landed in Paris at 23. Just to let you know before I read the poem, Rue de Mauvais Garçon means Street of the Bad Boys, and I did live there for a while. This poem is called We'll Always Have What Exactly. I climb a ladder to pick discarded twigs from blocked gutter. At the end of the roof where the slates swayed slightly in the storm these summer days set down upon us. Babies grown feathers and flown nests. Their beds now fodder for winds to wash down the grey slate going rotten, raining into gutters overflowing. Their home now at the reach of their wingspan, and not a chimney on a roof with gutters now gushing. I lived once on the top floor of a hotel room, at the darkest end of December and the beginning of a new breath. Rue de Mauvais Garçon, ça commence. C'est vrai que ce n'est pas la rue de Bon Enfant. The balcony, under gutter, was as economical with comfort as the thin pillows balancing on large lumps in the small bed. But I sat there, in the twinkling of a Christmas morning, in a tatty jumper and smoked Gaulois sans filtre, drinking champagne I'd nicked from the bar, wondering where to build my nest among the rooftops I watched, burning unsafe fires in chimneys as clogged as black lungs and too small to hold even a single fragile feather. I wonder if someone watches now from a balcony in Le Marais or across the grass of Belleville's Rien de Rien and catches the last twigs of my homes being blown into oblivion. And now it's time for our very first guest. This first poet has a Twitter nom de plume, which immediately tells us how her life started out and how it later unfolded. Perhaps it also shows us the positive outlook that her poems also divulge. She was a teacher and an athlete, and is now a writer documenting her life dealing with multiple sclerosis. Her poems have appeared in multiple online and print journals, and her latest collection, entitled Quicksand, is available from the Hybrid Press. This is Julie Stevens.
Hi, I'm Julie Stevens, but I'm known as Jumping Jules in the poetry world. I'd like to thank Damien for inviting me to take part in his brilliant podcast. Why Jumping Jewels? Well, I've got MS, multiple sclerosis, and I've had it for many, many years. I used to be an athlete, and jumping jewels reminds me of the person I used to be, and it brings a smile. It came to me when I was watching my son at gymnastics lessons, and it's kind of stuck. I've had my first chapbook published recently by Hybrid Press. I entered a competition, part of the Drike magazine, and I came second. My poems tend to reflect the impact MS has on my life. And my chapbook, Quicksand, is all about that. So I'm going to read some poems from that. In the first poem, I'm imagining what it would be like to fly. You can imagine, as a disabled person, what a thing that would be. Bird. I scooped handfuls of pink confetti, gave it wildly to the sky, and watched it float down to my hair, cheeks, nose, wings. And there I was, perched on my branch of blossom, singing thanks to my velvet landing and wings of release. My beak looks fine, don't you think? Playing this rousing tune to all around, collecting delight in my chocolate opal feathers, skinny legs like hers down the road, and royal stretching wings. But I can't stay. I need to taste the lift once more, feel the rush, and hover light, knowing I'm safe. I'll return to the grind when I'm done. These wings show me what it's like to soar. Come now. Ride with me. You won't stumble in clouds. Next poem is Lying in Bed. Early morning brings me to my senses. Another day to survive the madness of me. Can I lie here some more? It seems I'm flying this morning, hovering over a mattress by one finger length, rather than waking to a body full of splinters. Today, I'm suspended with dreamy voices whispering angelic words of an ideal existence. Can I lie here some more? Seems to be a fitting request. Activities start in the house. Cutlery crashing. Children shouting. I instantly land on a bed, no longer soft. It takes a few minutes of wriggling and pushing before I'm sat knowingly on the edge. The solid wall reassures me whilst I find my legs full of unsteady, leaking sludge. The floor doesn't seem safe anymore. My first steps are laboured, sinking in potholes left in strategic places. Slowly and tentatively, I reach the chest of drawers and enjoy its steady workmanship. I grab a stick and tap into my day. My collection of poems, Quicksand, can be purchased from hybriddrike.co.uk. I'm going to finish with my poem, If I Can't. If I can't walk that fast, then I'll start a new race. If I can't keep my balance, then I'll sing as I sway. If I can't use my hand, then I'll learn a new trick. If I get so very tired, then I'll run in my sleep. If the heat is too much, then I'll wave at the sun. If I forget the answer, then I'll find a new question. If I can't sleep at night, then I'll say good morning to the stars.
Ah. And while we're en route back to Ireland for our next poet, I'm going to stick with the theme of flight and bird and share a poem with you that I wrote a few years ago called In Flight. Movement matters mainly amid the currents of air I caress in flight, in dreaming at night. I fall freely under the breeze. I am taken, turned, tuned, am limitless, beyond boundary. I flit and flutter at my own folly, falling forward. I am light blazing, a burning star, burned out, barely visible, hardly begun, and yet unstoppable. I am man of the moon, first step. Freedom in flight, feathers rising in the night. All beneath a blanket of sleep. Our next guest is the author of two chapbooks and two collections. He has twice been the winner of the Irish Times New Irish Writing. His work has been published in Poetry Ireland Review, Acumen, Westerly and Into the Void. He's been nominated for Best of the Net and for the Pushcart Prize. He lives in Kildare with his wife and daughter Robin, who has already started writing poetry. His latest collection will be published by Golden Antelope Press and is called Days of Falling Fresh and Rising Moons. This is Steve Denehan.
Hello, my name is Steve Denehan and I'm going to read three poems that are due to be published next month in a book of mine that's on the way from the Golden Antelope Press. It's called Days of Falling Flesh and Rising Moons, and thanks a million to Damien for having me on, and congratulations on your own book, Damien. Eat the Storms. I have a copy here, I'm glad to say. Okay, here's a poem. It's about the only boxing match I was ever at, actually, and it's called Willie Big Bang Casey versus Guillermo Rigondeau, Dublin, March 19th, 2011. Willie took in the applause. The crowd was huge, heaving, his own. Rigondeau prowled, calm and emotionless, waiting with us for the bell. Ding, ding. We knew, even before the first punch was thrown, we knew. Rigondeau, not long defected from Cuba, eager to make up for lost time, moved, glided, floated an inch above the canvas, liquid mahogany, not hampered by the usual human machinations, not a man of bones and sinew, but of wind and mercury, sparks and young lightning. Willie, one of us, mortal, all heart, a trier. Rigondeau, something else, what we might have been, what he was. Willie, 2 minutes in, having not landed even one punch, floored by a short, sharp uppercut. So fast it connected almost before it was thrown. He sprung back up as if electrocuted, too quickly, too quickly. Should have taken the count. Should have caught his breath, found his legs, but this was his night, his crowd, his home. He held up his fists, the fight still in him. Rigondeau came forward, a B-movie baddie. Stalking, patient, waiting for an opening that came 20 seconds later. An opening that was filled with a blurred left hook that carried the anger and frustration of 10 fallow years. Years of fighting in cigar smoke and shadows. The canvas caught Willie and tried to hold him there. Stay down. Jesus, Willie, just stay down. He got up. Walked as if for the first time. Held up his fists. Was waved back in. For an ending that surely he didn't deserve. He leaned back against the ropes. Knowing. Waiting. They came, of course. The punches. Dozens, hundreds, thousands. In amongst it all, he threw one himself. It moved slowly, aimlessly through the barrage, an arrow through a hurricane. It missed. The referee stopped it. Finally. Willie, his fight, his career over. Looked around, there, but not really there. I caught eyes with him. He looked surprised. He was still standing. This next poem is actually quite long-ish, but I'll get through it quickly. It's called Floating. I float in the pool, stretch out as if the water has no end. I close my eyes, no aches, no pains. The water is warm. It could be amniotic fluid. I could be anywhere. I could be born again. The water churns as if boiling. I open my eyes to find another pair looking a question at me. He puts his hands on my shoulders, pulls me upright. I have been rescued, apparently. I wait until dusk. The pool is mine alone. The water is warm as the air. I close my eyes. Time idles by. I am floating in the sky, under an indifferent sun. The water is glass, an explosion. The glass shatters. He has come for a late swim. He grabs me from behind, begins to drag me to the side. I have been rescued. Again. The sun has fallen into the sea. I slide into its warm embrace, under the darkening sky. The softness of the salt water, the rolling sea air. I am held up as an offering, the only imperfection on a perfect horizon. There is barely a ripple. I can close my eyes. Behind me, Spain. North Africa, somewhere in the darkness. All I hear are the lolling waves, lonely nighttime seagulls, and screaming, and wild splashing, and with broken Spanish and hand signals, I calm him down. There is head shaking, eye rolling. My fault, my fault. Maybe someday they will realize not everybody wants to be rescued. Okay, and last poem. Thanks a million, Damien. And this is quite short. It's called Toilet Roll. Of course it is. Toilet Roll. I held the toilet roll in my hand, about to tear a few sheets, when it slipped and began its journey. I had visions of myself creaking up from the seat, crab walking to collect the unspooled paper. But no, a miracle. It bounded from me, rolled in a straight line, unravelling all the way. Bounced off the shower tray, rolling right back to me, gathering itself up as it returned. I reached down to pick it up. Felt my phone slip from my shirt pocket. Time slowed. I watched it fall. A heavy feather. Landing. Screen first. Half crunch, half smash. Hassle, hassle, hassle. I reached down, picked it up, winced. The glass shone. It was fine. Just fine. Like everything, it all meant nothing. But, standing up, I felt a lightness and walked into the rest of the day on the balls of my feet. Thanks a million, Damien, and best of luck with the book and with the podcast. Take care. Bye-bye.
I first met this next guest poet on a chilly Thursday evening at the beginning of this year as we nestled into the warmest snug of the tavern bar in Headford in Galway before setting off to Doolin with driver and fellow writer Aisling Keogh the following morning to the writer's retreat back in a time when hugs were not yet a dream. The energy and support of this next poet is so infectious and boundless that at times you forget she is also a writer, until, that is, when you listen in or end up sitting next to her at a workshop and the room falls silent and the magic flows from her. Her poetry has appeared in Backstory Journal, Cranogue, A New Ulster, Galway Review, Broadsheet.ie, Rope's Literary Journal and The Cabinet of Heed, to name but a few. This is Mary Maxwell.
Damien, thank you so much for the opportunity to read on your podcast. I feel very honoured and touched that you thought of me and that you wanted to share my words and writing, so thank you. I will start off with the piece that is based in Connemara, where I first moved when I returned back to Ireland. It's called At Lochinbeag. The geese are gathering at Lochinbeag, fluffing their wings and strutting the winter grass flat. They nestle in the towering pines along the riverbank, chattering and scuffling, pecking at wing and belly, grooming in the January afternoon light. Tawny feathers drift and collect, trail brokenly behind as beaks seek new growth. I imagine the angels visiting Lochinvig in the down blanket beneath the pines. In June, the swallows chase above the wild iris, buttercups, and the heather and indigo-tipped grasses. The geese, now silent, sit together, and the Connemara pony grazes all day. Up along the borings, the gale-gory inhale the sweet air, waft of donkey, cow, and sea. They dress for the big city, lynx and heels, coiffed hair and pancake makeup. Love and lust in their bones, while the ban on tea tries to douse their fire with curfew and routine. At Lochinvig the seasons pass and change. Electric lilac thistle bend farewell to the wild honeysuckle. In their stead the flowering blackberries twist and burrow along the stone-hewn walls. On Galway Bay a lone sailboat slides homeward. Arran is curtained in twilight, a beacon on the bay. Soon the bog cotton wisps dot the bogs. Families gather to bring the turf home. Bog cotton dervishes in the summer rainstorms, voices on the breeze, neighbors harvesting in late summer night, stories to be told over winter hearths. I think of you, Mom, and the seasons we've endured. Gone now. Naught but the stark barren coastline and twisted hawthorn limbs comfort the only way they know how. The rough meandering walls reminding me we can bend, twist, even break. But like the walls, wild grasses and the skeletal tree lines, we can splice new pathways. And we do, here at Lochinvig. My next piece came out of, again, we're in Connemara. This particular one, my friend was driving her daughter to her session at the Gaeltacht, and we ended up visiting Coral Beach, again in Connemara, and so this piece came out of that. My Malaysian friend. On Coral Beach, where the aquamarine waters trickle, we sat and yapped. Supped coffee from your flask, and ate okra, curry chicken, and jasmine rice. You read to me words of love, of ardor, your latest poetry. I'm smiling again at the roll of your tongue, sultry in mid-afternoon sunshine, undressing each word like the coral sanding our skin to smoothness, basking in moments of joy and friendship. As time and summer linger over Café au Lait and Connemara Coral. My last piece is based in Mayo, where I am now living. And again, my walks in nature and the gifts that I get from taking those walks. This is called Seasonal Change. When the bog cotton's gone and blackberries take their leave, whispers through the foliage. Gold doubloons and lemon drops, claret, crimson and ebony hues, through rush and wild grasses, tempt pathways cue deer. They bark in the shade of the berry trees, bid adieu to l'amour. Steal away along Loch Mask, where the limestone plays a tune, pheasant and mallard too, where the turlock arises, a floating island or two, where swans bed down, windsurf under gunmetal sky, the risen loch and easel, my winter palette. Thank you very much for the opportunity, Damien. Thanks for listening.
And before I introduce the next guest, I'm going to stick with the theme of coming home and Ireland itself. This next poem I'm going to read is called Grazing Greens and comes from my debut poetry collection, Eat the Storms, published by the Hedgehog Poetry Press. I set down upon your shores those grazing greens of my childhood memory, displaced as tears rain down over the darkness of your sleeping fields, once seeping with humble hope, once filled with a fine blood even famine could not blight, now flooded with a feeling of regret or relief, too dark to tell, too changed to recognize, not knowing if you are crying because I found my way home, or that I'd once made a home on another shore. Our next guest has had her poems anthologized by Cinnamon, Eyewear, Smokestack, along with appearing in many print magazines and online journals, including Ink, Sweat and Tears and Atrium. She is the organizer of the Poetry Cafe Refreshed and is Gloucestershire's stanza representative. She has two collections to her name. The first, entitled Interned at the Food Factory, was published by Indigo Dreams in 2019. And I'm thrilled to say that her second collection makes her a hoglet like me, as it is published by my own publisher at the Hedgehog Poetry Press. It is called Dualities. This is Sharon Larkin.
Hello, I'm Sharon Larkin. My collection, Dualities, from Hedgehog Poetry Press, has just been published, and I'm looking forward to receiving my copies this week. Thanks to Damien B. Donnelly for inviting me to contribute 2 or 3 poems from the book for his wonderful poetry podcast. And congratulations, Damien, on the publication of your collection, Eat the Storms, also from the brilliant Hedgehog Press. I'm thrilled to have become a fellow hoglet. Here's a preview from my collection, Dualities, which on one level at least is about relationship and difficulties relating. I've chosen one poem focusing on early in a partnership, one following a relationship breakdown and finishing in the glow of a happy lifelong relationship. After the ceremony, still in white, stilettos jettisoned in the sand, she skips along the beach with her bouquet in hand and her man still in his wedding suit. Newly matched, they strike out along the edge of the ocean. It glints, ignites the whole coast on this incandescent June day. Out of shot, higher up the strand, family and friends stand around, glasses charged and fizzing, sparking off conversation, as the bride blazes as bright as a comet might across a velvet midnight sky. Waves kiss the shore, swish, mimicking silk, as her skirts sweep above shell and silicate. A seabird calls from afar. The pair hurry on, oblivious to all around them, future bound. And the second poem is Release. The morning of the affidavit, he pulled back the curtains to find sooty mould had grown overnight on his prize of puntia, peered closer to note that the dark fuzz had an ugly face, pulsated when prodded, threatened to impale itself, become a fixture. already late to swear the oath, he googled bat. Checked rules pertaining to handling the species. Consulted bodies on how to remove this one without turning it into a corpse. Gardening gloves, brush and dustpan were his accessories to his act. He disentangled the blinking thing to transfer it to the outside world, where he expected it to flop around a bit, then flit off. And my last poem is Firewords. We struck Vestas to light the fire. It went out repeatedly until ignition seemed to come from somewhere other than our own hands, and then the firewords caught. Now we must watch over them, attend to the flame, or the firewords will falter. Our house will stay cold, and red-letter days cool to black. So we rise early each morning to lay the hearth, make a bed for the firewords, their crimson font. And we stay up late at night to settle the embers before sleep, bedded down between soft covers. We question the need to take so much care, suspect it could be all less of a chore. But the effort is necessary, for firewords are also bright children, hot with promise and rare reward, birthed in years of vigour into our fumbling hands. The firewords grow, become armour, protective in old age, forged in the labour of fire, the fire of labour. They flare up in the ardour of attentive parents, come to rest in a child's innocence. Thank you for listening to my poems, and thank you again to Damien for this podcast, and to Mark Davidson, the publisher at Hedgehog Poetry. If you'd like a copy of Dualities, it's on Amazon, or please order via PayPal from my website, which is www.sharonlarkinjones.com. Thank you.
And sticking a little bit longer with the title to Sharon Larkin's new collection from the Hedgehog Poetry Press, these next two poems of mine deal with the theme of duality. Whether it's wondering what if and what could have been in terms of adoption or not, or who we are destined to become, the better or the beast. This first poem is called In Parallel. What if we coexist concurrently, incredibly? What if we are dancing through this duality, indelibly? What if we are persons in parallel, apart? What if our only difference was our start? What if there were choices in the past that existed? What if there were bonds that held tight, that resisted? What if freedom of choice had been an option? What if it just wasn't the cold word of adoption? What if there are two of me living lives in parallel? One born to rules and the other to raise some hell. And this final poem is called Duality. And here is where we battle the truth. East or west, in the sun's heat or the moon that spies on our rest. and here is where our paths divide. The war to be won, or the human we are fighting to become. And here the Indian draws the honour. Wild man with boar's breath stands, with integrity held in honest hands. And there, in the east with helmet high, bearing the beast is fearless fighter, blundering into battle as bloody blighter. Are we then both moon and sun, tied tightly to burning planet and that eye watching nightly? Can we be honest behind the armour? Can the gorged blood be erased by a single flood? Can we be both brave and beast, cry at the famine and still eat at the feast? Are we not confusions caught beneath the confines? Are we not stars burning bright like the sun, but in the falling night? Are we born to be beasts, or born to brave the beast? Let us be wild boars, fearless in the face of our foe, gregarious in our need to grow. Ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, men and women, nonconformers and non-believers, gender X and gender equals, that is it for this episode. Thank you so much for joining us here, for following the journey, for listening to the voices. We will be back again, of course, next week with another episode, and coming very soon will be a very special LGBTQ episode, our own celebration of Pride, seen as Pride was a very low-key celebration this year. And in these days of social distancing, we all need to make sure that we are all being heard loud and proud. More details on that special event will be found soon on the website www.eatthestorms.com and on Instagram at eatthestorms. A huge thank you to my special guests today, Julie Stevens, Steve Denehan, Mary Maxwell and Sharon Larkin. And just to remind you that Julie, Steve and Sharon's new books are available to buy, and the links to them can be found on the Eat the Storms website, or how about you follow them on Twitter and show your support. Feel free to drop us an email here at eatthestorms@yahoo.com if you have any questions or ideas for future episodes, or if you're a poet and want to take part. All right then. I am Damien B. Donnelly. This has been Eat the Storms, the podcast. My own debut collection, also entitled Eat the Storms, published by the Hedgehog Poetry Press, is available to buy, and links to that can be found on the website or on Instagram. Meanwhile, stay safe, stay well, and most importantly, all together, because you know what I'm going to say, stay bloody poetic!